Dollar diplomacy entails pushing loans onto a country that are provided not by U.S. taxpayers, but by private U.S. banks. However, military force backs these loans, and as a condition of receiving these loans, U.S. banks get control over the finances and taxes of Latin American countries. These loans were usually negotiated by U.S. State Department officials, but because they did not come from the U.S. government itself, the U.S. could claim that it was only involved to protect American lives and property.
Officially, the policy of protecting American investments in Latin America began with Theodore Roosevelt's 1904 corollary to the Monroe Doctrine. The Monroe Doctrine, dating to 1823, had, rather fecklessly, declared Latin America off limits to any new European colonizing. Roosevelt extended the Monroe Doctrine to include the right of the United States government to intervene in Latin American countries for maintaining order, protecting the property investments of Western capitalists, and enforcing payment of international debt. As is often the case with U.S. policies, the Roosevelt corollary followed the actions of private actors. As unrest and discontent grew in the late 19th century, American capitalists embraced the idea that expansion was necessary for American democracy and the American way of life. They began acquiring lands and resources in Latin American countries.
In Nicaragua, U.S. investors established huge banana plantations in the 1890s, and by 1893 it controlled over 90% of the economy of the east coast of the country. When Jose Santos Zelaya came to power, he wanted to integrate the country economically and politically under his rule by expanding transportation links from Managua to the Atlantic. To pay for the expanding transportation links, he proposed taxing banana exports. He also approached rival European powers to sell rights to build a canal. U.S. interests in eastern Nicaragua and in the Taft administration denounced his rule and backed an eastern-based revolution in the country with gunboats. A conservative, pro-U.S. regime took power, which agreed to take up a loan that bound Nicaragua into a dependency status on U.S. investors. This loan was not meant to improve the infrastructure economy of Nicaragua, but to compensate conservative party members for the cost of waging the rebellion. Under Zelaya, Nicaragua's credit rating had been good, the treasury had been in surplus, and the currency was sound. His conservative successors, however, paid out large sums to supporters, thus eliminating the treasury surplus, and printed paper money, thus debasing the currency. When discontent grew in Nicaragua towards the conservative regime, State Department officials interpreted this as a need for more U.S. intervention, and President William Howard Taft sent 2,000 Marines. By the eve of World War I, Haiti, the Dominican Republic, and Nicaragua would be quasi-colonies of the United States. These receiverships were greatly beneficial to U.S. investors and to local elites, as they established large plantations, but they were not very beneficial to the peasants of these countries, who often had to pay higher taxes for these loans and who often had lost their farms. So in all three of these countries, peasant insurgencies arose. The U.S. government denounced these insurgencies as banditry. Characterizing peasant revolts as banditry transformed freedom struggles into criminality and justified sending troops to protect innocent lives. In all three countries, the press was censored, and in Haiti, it was made illegal to publish articles critical of U.S. troops. President Calvin Coolidge would double down on support for U.S. troops overseas, declaring in 1925 that the person and property of a citizen are part of the general domain of the nation, even when abroad. Government must afford protection to the persons and property of their citizens, wherever they may be.
In other words, U.S. imperial interests trump national sovereignty, a position consonant with the Roosevelt corollary, but also with Woodrow Wilson's liberal internationalism. The 1913 recession had intensified Wilson's conviction that economic expansion was necessary to protect American democracy. But economic expansion did not mean to him free and fair trade. Rather, it meant opening the doors of all smaller and weaker nations to the invasion of American capital and enterprise. This was evident in the contradictions between his domestic and foreign policies. Domestically, Wilson signed into law the Clayton Antitrust Act, which strengthened the enforcement of laws against large corporations which abused their market power to reduce competition. However, he repealed antitrust laws at water's edge and facilitated international banking through the 1919 Edge Act. He also intervened repeatedly in Latin American countries. And though avowing the principle of free trade in his 14 points program, he supported the League of Nations mandate system, which placed former Ottoman and German territory under control of Allied powers as a sacred trust of civilization. National sovereignty could only exist in name. All nations had to genuflect to Western capital, and Wilson wanted to prevent radical revolutions that would remove territories from American export markets. Wilson wasn't necessarily cynical. It was that the chauvinism of Western and U.S. purported progressive universalism precluded him from perceiving any country closed to Western capital as democratic and civilized. The policy that all nations must keep their markets open to Western capital was made official in 1899 and 1900 through the open door notes of Secretary of State John Hayes, who insisted that China, which had been divided into spheres of influence by European powers, should remain non-colonized and territorially sovereign. Territorial sovereignty was a farce, however, because China did not have the right to close off its markets. For the rest of the 20th century, the U.S. maintained the policy that only rogue nations closed their markets to American corporations, and such actions gave the U.S. the right to intervene in their affairs. Wilson's Republican successors accepted the position that economic expansion was necessary to preserve the American way of life, but they disagreed with his liberal internationalism. Whereas Wilson believed that the U.S. should work together with other great powers to maintain global order, Republicans believed that the world was too diverse to be made safe for democracy and simply sought to extend U.S. economic empire. To those ends, spending on the Commerce Department increased sixfold during the 1920s as Secretary of Commerce Herbert Hoover worked with corporate leaders to discover, develop, and control raw materials throughout the world. In Latin America, they fostered a political system of local rulers loyal to the basic interests of the U.S. Mexico became particularly important as it accounted for 40% of all U.S. oil production.
So when the president of Mexico in 1925 hinted at passing a new law increasing Mexico's share of oil profits, as U.S. corporations own most of the oil fields in Mexico, the response was practically hysteria from the U.S. State Department. Secretary of State Frank Kellogg claimed that this was part of a plot to spread Bolshevism to Mexico and then eventually the United States. Despite providing no evidence that Bolsheviks were involved in anything in Mexico, the Associated Press decided to carry a nationwide headline which stated that U.S. military intervention was necessary to stop Bolshevism in Mexico and Nicaragua.
Red Scare politics was a powerful mechanism that businessmen and politicians deployed in the 1920s to crush potential anti-capitalist radicalism at home and abroad. In 1919, emboldened by gains made during World War I, 4 million American workers went on strike for higher wages. The response of the press, which catered to the interests of well-off readers, as well as by Attorney General A. Mitchell Palmer, was to paint all organized labor as a vast communist conspiracy to overthrow the U.S. government and economy. This hysteria was fueled by the October Revolution that had occurred in Russia just a few years before. It was further stirred up by an anarchist campaign which set off bombs in 8 different cities. In response to this campaign, A. Mitchell Palmer led a series of raids, which rounded up thousands of suspected radicals and deported hundreds. Big business was able to exploit public sentiments against labor to refuse any labor demands, and implemented yellow dog contracts which forbade membership in unions. Consequently, union membership would fall from about 5 million members in 1923 to 3 million in 1933. But capitalists would not be quite as successful in Latin America.
Led by Augusto Sandino, ever larger and fiercer peasant insurgencies demanded the end of U.S. presence in Nicaragua. In 1929, Herbert Hoover sent nearly 6,000 troops to Nicaragua to suppress peasant
rebellions,
which grew in support of opposition to large-scale agrarian capitalism. The Sandino insurgency would inspire an anti-imperialist movement in Latin America and beyond. The U.S. government, as well as U.S. allies in Latin America, would respond with repression. Anti-imperialist intellectual and supporters in Latin America would be exiled, and in the U.S., the Coolidge and Hoover administrations would order that the post office not deliver mails from the Anti-Imperialist League. Still, the revolt continued, and eventually the U.S. allowed for elections to occur in Haiti and Nicaragua, although Haiti would not achieve full independence from U.S. financial control until 1947. After the United States set a firm date for withdrawal, Sandino agreed to a truce and disarmed his troops, but the U.S.-trained guard violated the agreement and shot him. The era of dollar diplomacy in Latin America represented an episode in the clash between two different ideas of freedom and civilization. For bankers, U.S. businessmen, and State Department officials, freedom and self-government could only be available to those they deemed civilized, to those who adopted American capitalism. This is not just a U.S. thing. The idea that freedom and self-determination is dependent upon some universal standard of progress and development is foundational to Western Enlightenment thought. As famous British philosopher John Stuart Mill wrote in On Liberty, "Despotism is a legitimate mode of government in dealing with barbarians, provided the end be their improvement." But what the anti-imperialist movement demonstrated is that there were many people throughout the world who rejected this understanding of modernity, that the rights of capitalism and finance did not trump the rights of people to choose their own economic and political destinies. Thank you for watching. Please remember to like, comment, and subscribe.